Secretary will read House Bill 386.
House Bill 386 by Representative Chanel of the 116th and others. A bill to be entitled an act to amend titles 48, 2, 28, 33, 36, 46, and 50 of the OCGA, relating respectively to revenue taxation, agriculture, the General Assembly, issuance, local government, public utilities, and for other purposes.
Chair Egan, I, Senator on the 31st, present tax bill.
Thank you, Mr. President. Members of the Senate, I bring to you House Bill 386. This is a culmination of many months of work by this legislative body, and many of you have been involved in that. But before I get started into the details of that, I got some formalities that we need to get out of the way. First off, I'd like to thank the House staff for all their many hours of work on this. They have put many hours of work into the drafting and into the research and working with the Senate on this issue. So I'd just like to express my appreciation to them. The chairman of the House Ways and Means Committee has worked very hard on this. The House Majority Leader, the House Minority Leader have worked very hard on this issue. And we appreciate their efforts on this. I'd also like to thank the council members who were appointed under the measures spelled out in House Bill 1405 that was passed in 2010. Those council members, men and women who have businesses and jobs here in Georgia, took time off out of their businesses and their work to travel all across this state and hold hearings on the things that Georgians felt like was most important to them. That was a couple of summers ago that they did that. They came back with a report to us, which you all have had, the beginning of last session. And that report and those ideas were then committed to the Joint Committee on Tax Reform and Fairness for Georgians. There were a number of folks who have served on that committee. I believe there's 12 of us total, 6 House members and 6 senators. And I would like to thank those members for the countless hours of work that they've put into this and the research and the study that they have provided. I'd also like to thank a couple of our members who have unique skills that most of us don't have, and that is the senator from the 9th and the former senator from the 28th, both CPAs. They put a ton of work into this as well. You all know a little bit about how this process works. We have a proposal and we gather information about the impacts and we hammer those issues out. We try to test them and validate the data that we're given, and I can tell you that those two senators were invaluable in their abilities to test the data from many different perspectives and in an effort to wring out anything that we might have overlooked or anything that might have been mischaracterized or how it might affect individual Georgians as they file income tax returns and pay taxes on the various services and products that they buy in the state. This is very much a pro-family, pro-jobs tax package. While I will tell you it is not as comprehensive as I once thought that it might be and certainly once hoped for, it is a good package. Is it perfect? No. And I will submit to you that I've never done anything perfect, certainly not here. And we typically, the whole reason we're here today is to correct those things that we feel like prior legislators did that was not, in our eyes, perfect. So this package is not to be sold to you as a perfect package, nor a complete package. Some could argue that it might not even qualify as tax reform, since in the grand scheme of things, this is a very small package. But it is pro-jobs, it is pro-family, it rewards those people for providing jobs to Georgians. It removes marriage penalties and does a number of other things that will benefit our families. And you can go home after this session or after today and be proud of voting for such a package. I'm not going to try to go through the bill line by line or even section by section, nor even in the order that the issues are taken up in the bill. I'm going to give you a 30,000-foot overview of this. And I understand that the senator from the ninth is going to follow me. As I said, he is a CPA, and he will be better able to answer detailed questions if you have questions specifically about how different sections will work. So I'm going to give you an overview of what we're doing, and frankly, I don't intend to take questions unless you want to come to me on the floor. I'll be out here, and I'll be glad to look through the bill and help you understand anything on a one-on-one basis. But just in respect for your time, I'm not going to stand out here and take up everyone's time to answer questions from individuals. As I said, this is a pro-jobs measure. This bill will protect jobs that are currently located in Georgia, and it will encourage other manufacturers to bring jobs to Georgia. A component of this bill that we have referred to is e-fairness, attempts to bring to level the playing field for those Georgians who are currently employing Georgians and currently paying taxes, our retailers that are in the state. It will attempt to level the playing field for them so they compete fairly with those out-of-state competitors. We cannot afford to ignore the evolution of the traditional market. You all know that the internet has made it extremely easy to make purchases online right from your easy chair while you're watching television at night. And many people are choosing to do so, and that rate is growing on an annual basis. So the tax law has, from its inception, sales tax law in 1951 has included sales and use tax, and we have had the use tax that we're talking about on these items has been a part of the law since it was, sales and use tax was first implemented back in 1951. And many folks didn't realize they owed those use taxes, but that law has existed, and this will help create a mechanism to collect those taxes. And when we collect taxes that are owed, it means that burden for those people who are doing what's right and paying their taxes, that burden will be relieved for them. The bill also includes a 30% credit or maintains the 30% film tax credit that we have adopted in this body. It does remove the sales tax exemption for items that are bought for the movie industry. They're good with that, and helps level that playing field. There are measures in here to exempt sales tax on certain construction materials for certain projects. This is a part of the governor's competitive initiative, and it will help the governor and our Department of Economic Development to recruit investment in this state and more jobs for Georgians. It eliminates the sales tax used on energy used for manufacturing. This has been an issue that has hurt our ability to recruit jobs here in Georgia. It levels that playing field. That's in conformity or compliance with the belief that you should not tax inputs into to a product that is then going to be taxed as a whole. So the Tax Council and the Governor's Competitive Initiative both recommended that. We have, as I said, we've spent a lot of time on this. We started off, we wanted to just eliminate it, boom, right out of the chute. That was rather costly. We've looked at models up to 7-year phase-in on that tax, and what the bill before you today does is compromise it at a 4-year level, 4-year phase-in. Georgia is currently one of only 10 states that tax energy used in manufacturing. This will help Georgia attract more companies such as Caterpillar that was announced just a few weeks ago that will be creating 1,400 jobs for Georgians. And this will save Georgia manufacturers approximately $150 million a year. It also revises exemptions on ag inputs and ag agricultural practices. Over the whole time that the legislature and the state has been doing taxation, there have been exemptions for ag reasons, and they have been brought before the legislature and adopted on an ongoing basis, and it's sort of a hodgepodge of ag exemptions. This bill strikes all those current exemptions and rewrites them, providing consistency across the code and how those things are implemented. I would point out to you that agriculture is one of the largest components to Georgia's economy, and it is appropriate, just as with energy used in manufacturing, not to tax those input costs. The bill also contains a measure dealing with conservation easements. It reduces the partnership caps to 500,000, and individual caps stay at 250. It also eliminates the transferability of credits for those conservation easements. This measure saves the state about $6 million per year. As I said, this is a pro-family tax package. Many of you have received emails from folks that read the original language that was introduced on House Bill 386. I don't know how they're still going back and looking at old language, but they did, and I know I got a ton of emails. The emails were reading the wrong version of the bill. This measure exempts retirement income for seniors at the level of $65,000, up to $65,000 per individual, or $130,000 for a couple. This is in addition to the, say, up to $40,000 of Social Security income that a retiree would receive tax-free. So retirees, seniors can theoretically have $170,000, $175,000 per year of non-taxable income. When we originally passed the retirement income exemptions, we believed that those exemptions would amount to around $200 million. But new data shows that those exemptions will have approximately a $700 million impact. So let me point out that this is not a tax increase for anyone. It just freezes the exclusion at the current levels. Let me also mention to you that there are, out of the almost 10 million Georgians, there are only 14,000 who have income over the exclusion limits. Let me also help put that into perspective. In order to exceed that $130,000 of retirement income for a senior couple or a retired couple, you would have to have $3 million or more dollars invested in the bank, earning 4% annual return in order to exceed that $130,000 exemption. The measure also provides a 3-year sales tax holiday for school supplies and energy and water efficient products. This sales tax cut amounts to an estimated $35 million every year for the next 3 years for Georgia consumers. And we would be one of the first states to support such a tax holiday. Again, reaffirming our commitment to Georgia's families and education. The measure also includes the elimination of ad valorem taxation and sales tax on the purchase of motor vehicles. Now, there's been some confusion on this. This eliminates the sales tax paid on the purchase of a motor vehicle, and it eliminates the ad valorem tax paid on motor vehicles. Those two taxes are eliminated. It then puts into place a title transfer, what we're referring to as a title transfer fee, of 6.5% to 7%. It starts at 6.5% and it works its way up to 7%. In most counties, I believe I'd be correct to say that in all counties except for two, the sales tax rate today is 7% or more. So there will be an immediate savings the day you purchase that vehicle, an immediate savings in the sales tax, what you would have paid for sales tax. And then you would not pay any ad valorem tax, what we've referred to as the birthday tax. Somebody came up with a pretty snazzy saying, puts the happy back into happy birthday. We've been talking about eliminating the birthday tax for a long time. This does it. I just want to reiterate that because there have been press reports, there's been emails that says that you now pay sales tax and a title fee. This eliminates sales tax and ad valorem taxes. The bill also reduces the marriage penalty in our income tax code by cutting income taxes for married couples. Unfortunately, Georgia still has a marriage penalty in its tax code, and this eliminates or increases that personal exemption for married couples by $2,000 per year, cutting taxes on families by $140 million every year. Now, some of you have heard the folks out in the hall, the folks out, I don't know where they exist on the internet and come up with this stuff. You need to be careful about reading all this stuff on the internet. You can find all kind of stuff out there. But there are those that says this process has moved too fast. I don't know how you move too fast on a tax cut in an economy like Georgia and this country and frankly the world is experiencing today. This has not been a fast process. Almost 2 years ago, towards the end of the 2010 session, this body, the General Assembly, passed House Bill 1405. And that laid out the process for this what we thought was going to be tax reform, what has been the result of this process. It created that council that went across the state taking input from Georgians. It created a joint committee. Six of you, five of you and me have served on, along with six House members. It created those things, House Bill 1405 did. The council went out there and heard from Georgians. Then the bills were introduced at the beginning, the very beginning of session last year. They have been out there. We have the joint committee has had a number of hearings. We've had hearings just to invite people to bring ideas, once again, to the process. So this is not something that some say it just wheeled out and we dreamed this up in the last 2 hours. That's not the case. I had someone come to me just today and said, can we just put this off till Monday? Can we talk about it today and vote on it on Monday? I don't know how 3 or 4 days could help you make a decision that you hadn't been able to make in 14 months. This has been a very lengthy process. We have spent a lot of time on this. We have invited you all to be involved in this process. And I believe that this creates the beginning of tax reform for Georgia. I think this is just one small step in the right direction. The process has been thorough. We have, and you all, members of the General Assembly, are very well of the fact that we've brought several packages out of the Joint Committee, and found problems with them, and held up on them, and worked those things out. There is nothing new in this package. This is all part of the original. It's all included in the original recommendation from the council, with one exception. That is one small part in there that deals with fuel tax on jet fuel. That has taken place this year. It has been pretty thoroughly vetted. It brings fairness to that industry. And we believe that that's the right measure to take. That is the only thing that's new in this. So today you have an opportunity to vote for a $262 million tax cut. That's $262 in the eyes of the taxpayer. That's not $262 million in the eyes of state government or local government, but that is from the taxpayer, the people who cast the votes for you and I and who entrust us to come down here and represent their interest. That $262 million is real dollars that your constituents will save in this process. It brings fairness. It is a responsible plan, and I would ask for your favorable support. I will be on the floor. If anybody has any questions about any part of the bill, I'll be glad to work with you on that. And I'd appreciate your favorable support.
You wish to answer a question?
No.
Okay. Well, let me hold on a second. Senator from the Ninth, recognized.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'll be quick on this because I know our time is of the essence. I want to thank Senator Heath for his help on this bill on the House side. Representative Mickey Chanel, who also co-chaired this with him, Representative Larry O'Neill, who's been very much a part of this. You know, this law passed 2 years ago, and 18 months ago they started a tax council of business people from all over the state. That went all over the state. I mean, they were in Savannah, they were in Macon, they were in North Georgia, they were in South Georgia. They went all over the state to listen to folks and get input on what should be in a tax bill. Last year, we tried to do a couple, as the chairman mentioned, and they were not successful, but we are at a point now where we think we're in a very successful mode on this bill. I want to also thank the Georgia Department of Revenue, because there are a number of people there that were working long hours working on numbers. Georgia Department of Economic Development, the Governor's Competitive Task Force. I don't know if most people understand how much time is put in on this, but for instance, last weekend, there were numerous people that were here 10 hours on Saturday, 10 hours on Sunday, working on the whole thing. Legislative Council staff, House staff, Sally Wallace from the Georgia State University Fiscal Research Center, Laura Wheeler from the Georgia State University Fiscal Research Center, my staff, Shauna, who put this presentation together for me. And I'll quickly go through this, and then if you have questions, I'd love to answer them for you. The state impact. To the state of Georgia, we come up with fiscal numbers for 3 years. We can look at these numbers. This is a state impact. I've handed out to many of you. I met with the minority leader in the House the other day for 30, 45 minutes. I met with the minority party this morning to give you some of these numbers. This is a state impact from title fees to personal exemption for married people, capital retirement exclusion, conservation easement, film tax credit exemption, energy phase out, agriculture, construction, jet fuel, e-fairness, sales tax holiday. This entire number for 3 years, the fiscal impact is in the red there of $62 million. For individuals, I'm not going to go to that line, but for individuals, this would be a tax cut of over $100 million for the state of Georgia. For your taxpayers in your districts, when you add up all the cumulative numbers, it's a $100 million tax reduction for individuals. It's about a $160 million tax cut for businesses in Georgia that hopefully will help employ folks throughout the state. This is a very positive bill. Some folks in Washington and even Grover Norquist has said that it's a tax cut, although I don't think he thinks it's the greatest tax cut he's ever seen in his life, but it is a tax cut. I will be open for questions if you have some.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 41st for a question. 41st, Minority Leader. Minority Leader.
Thank you. Ms. Speaker, we appreciate your time earlier today. Just want to ask a couple questions. On the marriage deduction, is this for people that only file the long form, and was there any consideration of how it would affect other married couples who don't file that tax form?
This is not for people that file the long form. It's for anyone who files a tax return. You do not have to file the long form to do this. This is not an itemized deduction. We increase the exemption. The exemption right now is, I think, $2,700 per person, and we increased it to $3,400. That extra $2,000 on an easy form would save in each individual married couple money on their tax returns.
Thank you. And one more question. Under the issue about local communities being able to reinstate the revenue from the manufacturing tax, and that would be a permanent reinstatement. It wouldn't phase out. And explain that a little bit, will you?
Thank you very much. It's a very good question. What we've done is, in this bill on energy, we get rid of the sales tax on energy both for state and for local. They both go away. But we allow the locals to reinstate theirs. So I'll give you the example that I hear from time to time. Folks around the Kia plant will say, hey, we already gave away the farm. We gave them a whole bunch of stuff to move here already. Now you're giving them energy and they're already here. Well, once we pass this, the city council, the county commission in that area, and I don't know which it is, could vote and say, hey, we already gave them the farm. We're not going to give them sales tax on energy as well. And they could vote it back in. So each individual city or county, depending on where they are at, could take a vote and reinstate the sales tax on energy. So they have the choice. The locals are still going to have the choice of whether they put sales tax on energy or not.
And just so, would that mean that the estimate on revenues, is that the loss to local communities, is that after you assume they all don't reinstate it? Or if they restate it, the loss won't be as great as shown in the fiscal note?
Thank you for that question. There is no effect in our sheets for locals on that item, because we can't tell you if locals are going to put it back on or not put it back on. So we have that as basically a zero effect on our report, because there's no way of telling who's going to put the sales tax back on and who isn't. I would argue, since we're giving them the choice, they get to decide. Therefore, it's not a fiscal issue for us. It's a fiscal issue that they will decide on their own. I hope I answered that efficiently.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 19th for a question.
Mr. Chairman, the previous senator from the 31st mentioned that there we did away with the transfers on conservation easement. Isn't it true that we just limited the transfer to one, that we did not do away with the transfer?
That is correct. We still have transfers, but instead of unlimited transfers, they have one, their ability to make one transfer. That is correct.
Chair recognizes Senator from 36th for a question.
Thank you, Mr. President. Does Senator yield?
Yes.
Could you give us some more background on exactly how it's going to work with the ad valorem tax, given that right now ad valorem tax is very important to the budgets of counties, cities, and school systems? I think it needs to be better understood as to how that's going to work, because my latest understanding is that, in fact, the counties will continue to collect and then remit to the state. Earlier, it had sounded like the state collected and remitted back. So maybe if you could give some clarity on that issue.
Thank you very much for that question, because that was to the heart of my difficulty when I looked at the car tag, right, to make sure that we're not the locals, whether it's city, county, or school systems combined, had about $700 million in car tax a year, in ad valorem tax on cars. So in getting rid of that, how do we stay whole? And what we're doing is, between that $700 million and about $300 million that they were getting in sales tax on the automobiles, about $1 billion, we've got written in this bill where we're guaranteeing them that $1 billion plus a 2% growth rate. How we came up with a 2% growth rate is, we looked at the last 10 years. In the last 10 years, the growth rate was about 0.6%. To a certain extent, that's not fair, because that includes the greatest recession since the Depression. So we looked at the first 5 years of the decade, which included a recession, just not anyone like now. And even in the first 5 years, it was about a 1.8% growth rate. So we thought it was adequate to come up with about a 2% growth rate on the $1 billion. So we guarantee them in the first year $1 billion, $20 million, in the second year $1 billion, $40 million, and the next year $1 billion, $60 million. And then we start looking back to make sure that the numbers are working and to make sure they're whole, where we can change the splits between at that 7% level between how much the state gets versus how much the locals get, to make sure the locals are whole.
And just for clarification, then, it's the latest understanding I've gotten is that they'll collect that title fee in the local county tax office and send the state's share to the state.
You are correct. That was the second half of your question. I did not answer it. That is absolutely correct. If I went to a Honda dealership in Gainesville, Georgia, or Flowery Branch, or the Grange, I need to make sure I go both ways on that. Yes, Senator. And I bought a car. Right now, the sales tax would go to the state. Right now, under current law,
right.
The way this would work, the title fee would go to the county or city in which it's located. The county or city would send the money to the state that is owed the state.
The state share, that's
the
right.
The state
that's
share, right. Yes.
If you'll yield for a further question.
Sure.
Isn't it true that we could have, I know there are a lot of concerns being expressed, I'm getting a lot of email, there's a lot of talk in the media and concerns about the speed of this proposal going through. It was unveiled, I think, to the public on Monday, voted on then in the House that afternoon, and here it is Thursday, and we are voting on it. Wouldn't it have been wise if we could have stayed away from all these wedge issue politics the whole session and stopped blocking women from health care access and testing mamas who are raising children with some TANF money and picketing and First Amendment rights and a great array of bills that have consumed a lot of time, standing in the schoolhouse door for the immigrant students who want to go to college. I mean, wouldn't it have been much more profitable use of our time to get into the meat of this subject as a body in the House and the Senate, and have had the time to get a thorough understanding, and allow budget analysts, independent as well as the ones that the committee has used, to really vet the numbers and be able to proceed with a greater degree of assurance that we're going down the right road in the right direction on such a big, important issue as the tax code of Georgia?
This is a large issue. There's no doubt about it. I would tell you that the Georgia State folks that we used are very independent, because I've argued with them on numbers, and I've argued with them on numbers, and I've argued with them about whether this is the right way to do it or the wrong way to do it, and I haven't moved them very far on my arguments yet. So they are pretty independent. And I will tell you this, when I knocked on doors two summers ago running for re-election, people were asking me about one issue, and only one issue, and it was jobs.
That's right.
What can we do for jobs? What can we do to increase jobs? And I would tell you, there's a lot of things in this bill that will help increase jobs.
Thank you, Senator.
The energy tax will help hopefully increase jobs. We lower the sales tax on cars and also encourage people not to have to pay the birthday tax. That may increase sales of cars. There's a lot of things in this bill that I think the discretionary money that the governor has to bring other companies here, like Caterpillars, the fairness issue in your local communities that will make it closer to being fair between out-of-state companies. I think a lot of these things are very good for Georgia businesses and will encourage job creation.
Thank you, Senator.
Thank you.
Senator in the well referred to the fact that he owned the Honda dealership in Gainesville. Senator, you can't afford that dealership, I'm just telling you. That is a high-dollar dealership run by a high-dollar man.
Well, I have another friend, Mr. President, who can help me out if that's the case.
That's right. Oh, no, that's an even bigger high-dollar man, I'm going to tell you. It ain't one dealership, it's multiple. All right, enough of that, back to business. Senator number 22nd, recognized for a question.
Thank you, Mr. President. Senator Yeal.
Yes, sir.
Senator, in the documentation I've got in front of me, I want to ask you a question as it relates to the motor vehicle ad valorem tax. I noticed that leased vehicles would remain taxable. Do we have any estimates as to what that revenue would be per year leading up to 2014?
Leased vehicles remain taxed just like they are now, so there wouldn't be a change of revenue.
Okay. The Senator, further you.
Yes.
Concerning purchased vehicles, currently local governments can count on an estimated amount of revenue per month as it relates to ad valorem taxes when I go in and pay the birthday tax. Now, with the implementation of this measure, I don't have that I can count on. What is the difference in terms of what we could count on versus, according to the legislation, the revenue would be divided according to a formula? Do we have any idea of what that minimum amount is? According to the legislation,
yes,
it says that.
Can you show me that where you're looking so I can? I'm sorry, I just don't understand the question.
Okay.
So
let me try to clarify it, Senator.
Is there a section of the bill? Or?
It probably is, but I'm using
okay,
my cheat
I'm,
sheet.
Okay, I'm sorry.
I'm using my cheat sheet now.
That's fine.
According to it says that revenue derived from the title fee will be divided according to formula between state and local governments, but the formula would guarantee that local governments receive a minimum level of funding. What is that amount?
Okay. You start off where we are today, where the locals are getting 3 and we're getting 4.
Okay.
Okay, that's where we start off. And then we start using the Georgia State estimates. I'm sorry, I didn't understand the question. Then we start using the Georgia State estimates because what we want to do, again, is keep the locals whole. So we start off by that $1 billion number, They're going to be at $1.02 billion the next year, $1.04 billion, the 2% increase. And we actually are keeping them on the high side of that because we were keeping them well above $1.02 billion to make sure they're whole. 3 years out, we start looking back and find out if those numbers are correct. If they're not correct and the state, the local area is too high, we'll change the formula. And it's not us that changes, it's the Department of Revenue, where they would look at, let's say the locals brought in $100 million more than they thought they'd bring in. We then would say, well, the $100 million, we're not giving back to anybody, but they already made $100 million too much, all right, fine. How much should the split be next year so that the locals don't get $100 million extra? The opposite is also true. If the locals lost $50 million, what would the split be? How would we change it? Maybe we'll go to the state gets 3% and the locals get 4% if that makes them whole.
The Senator, defer to you.
Yes.
In terms of that, my concern is that in communities where that 3% that you're talking about is much different than the 3% that's coming from my county. Help me reconcile that. And that's what I'm trying to understand. If we say that we're guaranteeing a minimum level of funding, is that a comparative minimum based on previous years or across all counties in the state of Georgia?
Well, we're basing it upon all the entire state of Georgia, this $1 billion. And the locals, both the cities and the counties, have come up with a formula to distribute that money between each city and each county.
Is that in the legislation?
Yes.
Okay.
And I can show you more information on that, but it's detailed, and it wasn't something we came up with. It was something that the local governments came up with to analyze how you give that $1 billion that we're taking away from them back to them.
Okay.
Yes.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 34th for a question.
Thank you, Mr. President. Would a senator yield?
Yes, ma'am.
Senator, is it not true that my county, Clayton County, I have quite a number of folk who are very interested in this bill and have great concerns about one line item that I was unable to effectively explain it? Can you just elaborate a little bit more on the jet fuel exemption line item?
Yes, ma'am. Right now on jet fuel, the state charges 4% like we charge 4% for everything else. That's the state portion, not the Clayton County, not the local portion, just the state portion. We're reducing the 4% that the state gets for fuel for airlines down to 3%. The state portion is being reduced from 4% to 3%. We could argue that hopefully this encourages more planes. Now, in the past, that has been sometimes just for Delta, sometimes just for Hartsfield Airport. This is for all airports in the state of Georgia and all aircraft carriers in the state that are in the state of Georgia. So hopefully this helps not just Hartsfield Airport, but encourages more flights to Savannah and Macon and some outlying areas. And my other thought is, as we lower the rates, you know, airplanes, you know, this airplane may be in 5 different cities in a day, maybe in 10 different cities in a day, and they'll analyze where the fuel's the cheapest when they fill up. Now, if they're out of fuel or they're close to out of fuel, they got to fill up no matter what. But they may be topping off. If they land in Atlanta and the price in Atlanta is less, they may be topping off their tanks here because the next city they go to, it may be a lot higher. And so we believe, although these numbers are not dynamic, we just got to take the 4% and say what we're losing. The loss that is on this screen of $55 million over 3 years is a loss to the state of going from 4% to 3%, just the state portion.
Senator, can I do a follow-up if you'll continue to yield?
Absolutely, sure.
Okay. Senator, having said that, the only other question that is paramount in Clayton County is jobs. Will any of this in this legislation help with jobs overall for the state of Georgia and or Clayton?
I think I can go line by line through it, but I think it would help Clayton County. It's going to help the Atlanta Airport. It's going to help sell more fuel out of the terminals there, which some are in Clayton and I don't know if they're all in Clayton at the airport, but it will encourage that. We have energy and manufacturing, which I'm not sure how much you have in Gwinnett. We don't necessarily have a lot of manufacturing, but in North Georgia and Dalton, Georgia, and other places where we have carpet industries that's hurting greatly and high unemployment, it's going to help those areas. I don't know which senator got the Caterpillar plant, but he's very happy about that, or she's very happy about that. If we could bring five more Caterpillar plants to whichever district, and it doesn't matter if it's in your district or the one next to you, so those people are going to live in your district. I mean, and then there's jobs, and those people go to work. And I mean, the exponential effect of having jobs and new jobs in these plants, I think, is just fantastic. And those numbers can't be put in here. Those, we don't do a dynamic forecasting. Sometimes we'd like to, but we can't. But I believe this is a fantastic way of trying to do things to increase jobs for the state of Georgia. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, Senator.
Chair Ganassa, Senator from the 10th.
Thank you, Mr. President. Would Senator yield?
Yes, sir.
Senator, isn't it true that the local community will be better off under this bill because of the phase-out of ad valorem and the collection of the title tax?
I think that's absolutely true. The we could end up selling more cars with we could help the local guy that sells TVs, where they might buy the TVs at their place versus online. It puts them in a competitive equilibrium versus the disadvantage they're in today. It helps your mom and pop. It helps your local businesses. I think it helps everyone in every single one of our communities of the state.
Thank you. Senator Yeo?
Yes, sir.
Senator, isn't it also true that there's an exemption for paying the title tax when cars are transferred between family members?
There is that. That is correct as well. Absolutely.
Thank you, Senator.
Thank you.
No further questions, Senator.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. I will just in closing say, for my portion, this is a $262 million tax decrease. Is it perfect? No. I'm in the well. It must not be perfect. But it's pretty good. It really is. I think it does a great job. And I would encourage each and every one of you to vote yes. I know when you knock on doors this summer, the biggest question is jobs. And this will help jobs in our cities and our counties and our state. Thank you very much.
Chair recognized, Senator of the 41st, the minority leader, speak to the bill.
Mr. President, members of the Senate, I appreciate your time today talking about this important issue. As we know, this state has faced a tough time over the last few years, with revenues declining in part because of the economy and in part because of decisions to cut taxes both before and after the economy started to get into trouble with our national recession. I appreciate very much the Senator from the 31st, the Senator from the 9th. Senator from the 9th, when this bill was presented to our Tax Reform Commission, you know, as soon as he presented it, he said, you know, if you need time, I'll come to your caucus and give you some information. We appreciate that. But I do want to point out, and I feel obliged to point out to you, that although these elements of the Tax Reform Commission plan have been around for a long time, and whereas this information is something we could have all gotten on individual parts of the plan, it's not true that the whole plan that we could integrate into a bill, see what the total effect would be, was presented a long time ago and that we've had a lot of time to look at it. The truth is, really only Monday of this week, in a very short period of time, we all, Democrats and Republicans, have had to digest a very complex, comprehensive plan. And this has been, a real challenge for many of us, and really a disservice to our constituents that I hope we would try to avoid. Now, I believe in this case, many people probably tried to get things sooner, but the fact is, here we are only a few days having to digest a bill that has major, major ramifications to the citizens of Georgia on where and how their tax dollars are collected. First, I'd like to ask you to think about the manufacturing tax cut. This is something that the chairman of my caucus had put in before. Many members of my caucus have supported. And so, you know, when you take it into a whole plan, you've got to evaluate the whole situation. And we're hoping that this part will create some jobs in Georgia. But I want to point out to each of you, and I want the citizens of Georgia to know, that this is not a master stroke that is going to revive manufacturing in Georgia, nor is it the initiative that we need to hang our hats on when we go home to our districts. Right now, Georgia is second in the nation of lowest taxes for labor-intensive manufacture. We are eighth lowest in the nation for manufacturing that is capital intensive. This is from the Tax Foundation, a conservative group that had a very esteemed accounting and actuarial firm do the study. So we're very low in taxes on manufacturing in Georgia. This change will not be a dramatic change from a low tax state, but hopefully it'll help. And it's one of the reasons that ultimately I'll vote for this bill. But there are other concerns that we need to look at in Georgia. Those concerns include what foundation we're building for the future. As we look at tax cuts in this bill, we realize the true challenge to our future lies in the investment we are making in our children and our state. We have a $1.8 billion shortfall in education that is impacting every day whether businesses want to come to Georgia, relocate in Georgia, and impacts every day in the future of Georgia's children. Neither a bill about how schools are run or another break for taxes for business that we already are low taxed on anyway are going to make the kind of impact that us truly investing in our children will make in making Georgia grow and be prosperous. We also have many infrastructure needs that we should invest in, because I know that once Hartsfield was in, when we moved to Atlanta in 70, they were just building a perimeter. And throughout my youth, I realized Atlanta was growing because of the roads and the transportation hub that existed. We're losing our competitiveness and our advantage in those areas because we're not investing. We also know that there are many other needs for infrastructure, from bridges to sewers and water supplies that need to be invested in. And we have to look at those things. This bill, cutting taxes next year and the year after, you don't address those problems and creates more challenges. Many departments have suffered. So I want to have each of you look at the challenges of Georgia in the long term and realize that we've got to invest in Georgia's children, especially in making sure that we can win the battle with other states in attracting businesses and improving the lives of our citizens. Certainly, one tax cut that we passed a few years ago was the income tax cut for retirees, something we all like to do, but one that hit the state budget very hard. This puts a cap on that, a reasonable cap where a couple will make $130,000 a year will fall under it, and hopefully you all feel comfortable with that, but that's another beneficial atmosphere of this bill. The e-fairness tax is another thing. We realize that the state tax code from 1937 and revised in 1951 has not really kept pace with the kind of technological changes and advancements in economic structure of our system, and we need to look at how those changes need to be addressed in the future. and probably in a more comprehensive way than this bill actually does. So the e-fairness brings in a new type of people's buying and purchasing and habits. It allows us to raise some revenue, although probably only about 20 million, 5% of the over 400 million in e-traffic tax revenue that would be out there. But it is a step in the advancement of our look at what our tax structure is now that we're a more modern and changing economic base. So I plan to vote for this bill. I would have liked more time to look at the comprehensive package and all the elements of it, but I understand that we are faced here with a decision that well-meaning people brought this to us, and in this short period of time since the full package has been assembled, have done what they could. So I hope each and every one of you will look at the various parts of it and how it impacts your constituents and make that decision. I yield the well if there's any questions. If there's not any questions.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 54th for a question.
Mr. President, will the minority leader yield?
I yield.
Thank you, Mr. Leader. Isn't it true that our state has lost and is losing manufacturing jobs to neighboring states based on the differential in energy costs?
You know, when looking at most of the lost jobs in Georgia, it has not necessarily been to surrounding states. Very few jobs of a percentage have been lost to surrounding states. And I will contend to you that those states also are starting to move ahead of us in the realm of our educated workforce that's available for training and providing a workforce for those. So I think other factors have weighed in much more. If you look at our surrounding states' total tax structure, Georgia is very competitive for manufacturing industries. As I stated earlier, we are second in the country in lowest taxes on manufacturing. So only a few specific type industries that use an excessive amount of energy have been impacted by this, and they're very select group would be swayed by this type of tax cut.
Thank you, Mr. Leader. Will you continue to yield?
I continue to yield.
Isn't it true that regardless of the rate in terms of ranking for second or any other ranking in terms of the rate of taxation, that most modern manufacturing is energy intensive? And in fact, because we're in a world economy for labor, we're going to have a difficult time competing in the labor market globally, such that when we're talking about input costs, raw materials and energy drive most of the area where we can be competitive as a state and a country for manufacturing jobs.
And as I stated, when you take the entire tax structure, including the manufacturing input, and I'm glad you brought it up, certainly, you know, they're not quite frankly as probably as energy consumptive as they were 20 years ago. Efficiencies have abounded in business too, but they are energy users at a high rate. But even taking in all those factors, we are lower than the surrounding states in our overall tax rate for manufacturers.
Thank you, Mr. Senator.
At present.
We continue to yield?
Yes, I yield.
Just one final thing. Would you agree with me that there are districts that are more heavily industrialized than yours that are readily seeing the impact of neighboring states not taxing energy used in manufacturing and are seeing loss of jobs and are seeing new construction of new yarn manufacturing plants and other advanced manufacturing energy intensive plants locating outside of Georgia in industries that are housed in Georgia?
I think that certainly you can see businesses who have open offices outside of the state. I will contend that they are not moving primarily because of the energy costs, but a wholesale, a great number of reasons. And energy costs are a factor, which is one reason I said that I had supported it previously. A caucus chair had put in a bill about it, and that it was one of the positive things that might create some jobs. But I don't want people come, you know, to be of the belief that this is going to be a panacea for Georgia and job creation or the greatest tool in job creation since the power loom, you know. So, yeah, I just don't want people to, you know, be able to sell this as just fixing all our problems. But I will be happy and I will be joyous if this bill passes to come back next January if we've increased 3 million jobs in Georgia or or even a quarter million jobs in Georgia because of passage of this bill?
3 million would be fantastic, Mr. Leader. If you can find them, I'll take them. I appreciate it, Mr. Leader. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you very much.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 31st.
Thank you, Mr. President. Mr. Leader, do you yield?
I yield. Thank you.
Did you serve on the Joint Committee?
I was on the Revenue Commission.
Did you ever ask any questions of me that went unanswered during that process?
Did I ever ask any questions that weren't answered during the commission?
Of me.
Of the bill? No, not since we saw the bill Monday.
Or at any other point prior to that?
As you know, Senator, I was not on the commission until recently, so.
Just this year.
Yeah, so there wasn't that many commission meetings that I was able to attend.
Senator, I just wanted to publicly thank you for your service on there. You were faithful in attending the meetings and participating in the process, and I just want to thank you for your time.
Thank you.
No further questions, Senator.
Thank you.
Chair recognizes 733rd. Speak to the bill.
Thank you, Mr. President, and ladies and gentlemen of the Senate. I'm glad to have the opportunity to finally say something about this measure. I was on the commission also. I will say that there was one meeting, and I won't name the office, there was one meeting in this Capitol where I think most of the Revenue Structure Committee was there. So I walked in and made sure they heard me when I asked the secretary, am I supposed to be in there? She said, no, I don't think so. But that wasn't the chairman. The chairman's been very good to invite me, and I will say that it was not the chairman. I will say that I don't see how you pass a tax cut that's complicated and leave it out there too long before one group or another tears you apart. I do think timing is not as good as it could be, but I understand the premise and what they had to fight. This is a better bill than they had last year. Last year, we were a couple hundred million dollars off, and it was gauged toward income tax, and I think the way they did the marriage exemption is an excellent idea, and they focused in on one. The governor's office was involved. I understand UGA, in addition to state, Georgia State was involved. Dr. Tutterow and the members of the commission that traveled around, he's an economist. But let me say this. I like some of the provisions, and like I say, there are things that every one of us would have done differently. But as I look at the title fee, the first one on the motor cars, that's an excellent proposition. That is probably the most hated tax in Georgia other than your ad valorem tax on your house. And you don't see that as much because it's usually paid by your mortgage company. But this one you see on your birthday, and it knocks your socks off. And people hate it. I think this will work. And I commend whoever came up with that idea. The personal exemptions for married filers, we did choose one particular base to gratify. And, of course, marriages have fallen by 3%. In Georgia overall, but you take in the population increases, then that's where they get the money. I was disappointed that marriage was falling in Georgia because I've been trying to get it right. I like that, but I do think it serves a large number of our constituencies and a good contributing segment of our contributors, of our communities. Let me see. The conservation easement, the manufacturing exemption is absolutely necessary. I said last year, if you'll come up with a tax exemption for manufacturing, I'll vote for it today. in this country, even though we might have the lowest taxes, or second lowest taxes, whether it be labor or capital or whatever, I would say that we don't make anything anymore. And we do, with agricultural products, it's number one or two, and tourism's the other one. So that justifies the film exemption. But we don't make anything anymore. The last suit I got was assembled in New York, sold to me in Georgia, and made in China. And we need to return, especially textiles and things we've been good at, we need to return the health of that industry. I like that section of the bill. You know, what used to, when we had these things appointed and you had a token member appointed, it was then a Republican, now I'm a token Democrat, or was one of two. You ought to clue them in, because I like what you did. I would have said things about it better. The chairman has tried to keep me informed, but I think some of the House leadership was a little tight on some of their ideas, and they didn't appreciate some of my questions. I know that. But we were civil. The agricultural exemption being number one or two, yes, I think it's excellent. Construction materials, good thinking. And it's hard to criticize the areas that they approached and attacked. Now, the internet thing, fine. I hope we're able to collect it. And I hope everybody is able to enforce this, and the Revenue Department is able to enforce it. Let me tell you something. The only problem I've ever had, especially last year, was trying to move too fast. And when we found out we were a couple hundred million off one day, and then we found out we did not serve the middle class as well as we were trying to, it was a combination of pushing people for numbers and different people asking for numbers of the university and some confusion that they encountered there. I think it's been more focused, and they got a group that were pulled in to give good estimates. The one thing we will say, and I think the chairman might even agree with me, is that changing an overall structure of revenue is a little bit like shooting in the dark with a little bit of light behind you because of the history you have. But it's hard to say what will happen tomorrow in any tax restructuring. And this is balanced and minor. They've even got some safety nets in here, like the three-year deal on one of them. It's hard to project what our revenue is going to be, because we never thought we'd lose $5 or $6 billion either. You know, that we didn't. It wasn't Georgia's fault. The whole country experienced this, and the whole world. Let me just say that I think they've come up with a reasonable proposal, and I'm going to vote for it. I hope the figures are right. I think they've tried to make them right, and I enjoyed it. So I'm going to vote in favor of this bill, and tell you that I think a lot of work went into it, and I wish I could have been more a part and helped more. But I recommend it to you. We've got to do something, and it looks like a good proposal to cut taxes for a lot of different groups in Georgia. So having said that statement, I don't think there's any questions. I yield.
Did you want to take questions or no? Senator from 31st has a question.
I knew that was coming.
Senator, do you yield?
I do.
Senator, isn't it true that to be a token minority party member on one of the most important committees, you've been a pretty good member?
Well, isn't it true? I thank you very much, and I appreciate your leadership, and that's the reason I wanted to stress. You have tried to keep me informed, and I'm grateful.
Well,
thank you.
Let the record show that you've been a huge asset to the committee, and we appreciate your time.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Chair recognizes Senator 21st. Speak to the bill.
Thank you, Mr. President. Considering where we were a couple of hours ago, this seems like almost a kumbaya moment here, so I'll be rather quick. The bill has, while not perfect, as the senator from the ninth brought out, the bill has far more positive aspects than it does negative. I want to first talk about the marriage penalty. The notion that we actually penalize marriage in this state is one that ought to offend everybody in this room, and this bill begins the process of eliminating that penalty. That's good. If we can stand for marriage and leave this place saying that we helped out families, we've done quite a bit. I also want to congratulate the senator from the 8th, who I'm not sure he's in the chamber right now, but 5 years ago, he and I actually toured this state when he was in the minority party on this exact issue of manufacturing and the manufacturing future of Georgia. And what we heard time and time and time again was we've got to reduce the cost of energy. And in fact, we talked about that 5 years ago. He told me recently that he dropped a bill in 1997 to eliminate the sales tax for energy used in manufacturing. So this is, I know some have claimed that these are new ideas. 1997, as the energy champion in the back raises his hand. We're one of only 10 states that still has a tax on energy used in manufacturing. The birthday tax, there's been a lot of confusion and maybe some misreporting on it. This is very simple. We're taking two taxes, getting rid of them and replacing them with one to simplify the system so that we treat all sales of automobiles exactly the same, so that government policy isn't to treat one way, one another, but to treat everybody equally. The sales tax holiday is coming back. That is a good thing. Every single state that surrounds us has a sales tax holiday. Our border communities desperately need this, and it's good for the taxpayers of Georgia. And then I'll close with this. The last few years have been tough on all 50 states. Some have gone one way, others have gone another. I'm proud to say that we have gone the way of cutting spending, balancing our budget, and cutting taxes. According to the Brookings Institute, 40 states have raised taxes between 2009 and 2011. Georgia has cut taxes, and we're going to do that again today. And the best part about that is we're beginning to see the fruits of making those tough decisions. 7 consecutive months of declining unemployment, and the report that just came out yesterday shows Atlanta as the second best metro city in the United States for job creation. This plan of reducing spending, balancing our budget, and cutting taxes works. It has always worked. It will always work, and we're adding to that today. So, Mr. President, if there are no questions, I yield the well.
One question. Senator from 33rd is recognized.
Mr. Leader.
Yes, sir.
You and I have had adversarial debates and very, very spirited debates, but we are friends, aren't we?
You are my dear friend, yes.
We're personal friends, and that's true. Isn't it true that I agree with the comments that you've made? And let me ask you, when we can afford it, wouldn't it be a good idea to reinstate that property tax exemption of $400 million when we can and make that permanent when we can afford it?
Senator, I would go even further. When we can afford it, I say we just get rid of the property tax altogether.
I like it.
But thank you for that question, because that was well delivered.
No further questions. Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the bill? Is the objection granted? Port of committee which failed pass the bill. Chair is none. Port of committee is agreed to. Shall the main question be now put? Are there any objections? Chair is none. Main question is ordered. Shall this bill now pass? Question is on the pass of the bill. All those in favor of the bill will vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary will unlock the machine. On the passage of the bill, the yeas are 54, the nays are 0. Congratulations. This bill, having received a constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Secretary will read HB 272.
House Bill 272 by Representative Weldon of the 3rd and others, a bill to be entitled an act to amend Part 2 of Article 1 of Chapter 11 of Title 15 of the OCGA relating to juvenile court administration and for other purposes. Committee of the Senate on Judiciary recommends that this bill do pass.
There is a substitute. Do I read?
Yep.
Okay.
Senate Judiciary Committee offers the following substitute to House Bill 272. Bill to be entitled an act to amend Part 2 of Article 1 of Chapter 11 of Title 15 of the OCGA relating to juvenile court administration and for other purposes.
Chair recognized, Senator from the 54th.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, members of the Senate, for the opportunity to present House Bill 272, a bill which is substantially shorter than the last bill we took up. I expect the debate to be shorter, but I hope the result is the same. House Bill 272 does two things to the way we manage juvenile court in Georgia. One is it eliminates an old automatic rehearing right that came out of any time an associate juvenile court judge heard a case. That dates from a time when associate juvenile court judges were not required for the same educational or experiential training as juvenile court judges. Today they are. And the next it does, for the same reason, allow for an associate juvenile court judge to serve as a judge pro tem in the absence or disability of a juvenile court judge. Those are the two things it does. I would certainly welcome any questions and yield for them. Otherwise, Mr. President, I yield the will and ask favorable consideration.
No questions, Senator.
Thank you.
Question on the adoption of committee substitute. Is there objection? Without objection, committee substitute is adopted. Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the bill? Is there objection granted? Port of committee which failed pass the bill. Chair is none. Port of committee is agreed to. Shall the main question be now put? Are there any objections? Chair is none. Main question is ordered. Shall this bill now pass? Question on the pass of the bill. All those in favor of the bill will vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary will unlock the machine. I think that's a woman's picture, not a Lieutenant Governor's picture. Thank you. on the passage of the bill. The yeas are 50 and the nays are 0. This bill, AMCRX constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Secretary will read House Bill 297.
House Bill 297, by Representative Maxwell the 17th and others, a bill to be entitled an act to amend Article 1 of Chapter 1 of Title 47 of the OCGEA relating to general provisions relative to retirement and pensions and for other purposes. Committee of the Senate on Retirement recommends that this bill do pass. There is a fiscal note attached to the bill.
Chair recognized, Senator 54th, present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, members of the Senate, for the opportunity to present House Bill 297. We are on a roll now. House Bill 297, often referred to as a dead peasant bill, passed the House without an opposing vote and passed out of retirement committee unanimously. The bill essentially would preclude our retirement systems for taking an interest in a life insurance policy on the life of on the lives of members. We do not currently do that. There have been other states that have attempted to do that and voted it down. An attempt was made in 2010 in this General Assembly, and it did not move, but there's concern that there may be efforts in the future. It's bad financial policy for a retirement system, and so we want to make clear in our code that this is not an appropriate investment for our retirement systems. And I'd ask your favorable consideration, Mr. President. If there are no questions, I would yield the well.
No questions, Senator.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the bill? Is the objection agreed in the portal committee, which failed to pass the bill? Chair is none. Portal committee is agreed to. Shall the main question be now put? Are there any objections? Chair is none. Main question is ordered. Shall this bill now pass? Questions on the pass of the bill. All of those in favor of the bill will vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary will unlock the machine. On the pass of the bill, the yeas are 52 and the nays are 0, and this bill, AMCRX constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Chair recognized, Senator from the 53rd.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'd like to make an announcement. The Senate Transportation Committee will meet at 3 o'clock outside the chamber on the rail, outside the pro tem's office. We're going to do the business of the people.
I thought that's what we were doing in this chamber. Oh. We just gave every transportation person in Georgia a tax relief. All right, very good. All right. 3 o'clock. Secretary Reed, House Bill 472.
House Bill 472 by Representative Smith of the 131st and others. Bill to be entitled an act to amend Code Section 3536 of the OCGA related to the brewpub exemption of the three-tier distribution system and for other purposes. Committee of the Senate on Regulated Industries and Utilities recommends that this bill do pass.
Chair recognizes Senator 29th. Present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise to present to you House Bill 472. This bill simply provides that brew pubs are able to manufacture 10,000 over 5,000 barrels of beer and for distribution from 500 to 5,000. This is an emerging industry in our state. Passage of this bill will create jobs around our state, and that's pretty much it. I'll be glad to yield to any questions. If there are no questions, I'll yield the will.
No questions, Senator. Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the bill? Is the objection granted? Port of committee which failed pass the bill? Chairs none. Port of committee has agreed to. Shall the main question be now put? Are there any objections? Chairs none. Main question is ordered. Shall this bill now pass? Questions on the pass of the bill? All those in favor of the bill will vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary will unlock the machine. On the pass of the bill, the yeas are 49, the nays are 1. This bill, MC Rex Constitution majority, is therefore passed. Have an adjournment resolution. Secretary will read.
House Resolution 1978 by Representative O'Neill, the 146th. Resolution relative to adjournment and for other purposes.
Chair recognizes the majority leader.
Thank you, Mr. President. Best news of today, even better than 54-0. We're going to be out next week. This adjournment resolution carries us through the end of the session next week, Monday, Tuesday, and Thursday, which will be day 40. We'll be coming in on Monday, we believe, at probably around 1 o'clock, but sometime in the afternoon so the committee meetings can be held earlier in the day. And then we'll close out legislative day 40 on Thursday. And by the way, I think we've had only 3 of these all year long. Only 3 adjournment resolutions all year long. That's how far in advance we've been able to plan out this year. And that is due largely in part to this body working so well and really moving at a pace that I haven't seen in my decade in this General Assembly. So thank you for all the support. And this is a good news bill.
Questions. Chair recognizes Senator the 55th.
The Senator yield?
Yes, Senator, I do.
Senator, is it not true that I love this place and all of the members that serve in this body? And I refuse to go home.
You can vote your conscience.
Chair recognizes him, 33rd.
Neil.
Yes, Senator, I do.
Does this mean y'all are finally getting the hang of it?
It took us a while, but we're in full gear now.
Chair recognizes Senator 14.
Thank you, Mr. President. Senator Yield.
Yes, Senator, I do.
Senator, we have yet to hear from Columbus about the arrangements for the senator's wife. I don't know whether it'd be in order to delay a vote on this or possibly amend it. I mean, we don't know whether the arrangements will be Sunday or Monday, but the Senate needs to be at ease while that's going on. Or we would amend it later, or we would have the opportunity.
Senator, I would agree. I will say this, that our counterparts in the House have been so good to work with this year on any and all schedule changes that I would prefer that we pass this, and then once we have definitive information, go back to them if we need to make a change, and I'm sure they'll agree with us.
Thank you, sir.
No further questions.
I yield the well.
Is there objection? Without objection, the adjournment resolution and the 40th day is set. Secretary will read House Bill 535.
House Bill 535, Representative Oliver of the 83rd and others, a bill to be entitled an act to amend Part 2 of Article 2 of Chapter 4, Title 38 of the OCGA related to war veterans' homes and for other purposes. The Committee of the Senate on Appropriations recommend that this bill do pass.
Chair recognized, Senator of the 45th. Present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. President. Members of the Senate, I present to you House Bill 535. This bill gives authority to the Georgia Veterans Services to accept aid and attendance benefits. Georgia is the only state of 50 states that does not participate and receive this subsidy. We will save between $3 and $6 million for the Veterans Administration, and most importantly, this will allow more veterans to be served in their nursing homes. This is only the beginning of modernizing the structure of the state veterans nursing home. As most of you know, the Appropriations Committee has been working on this for the past 3 years, and we see it as a beginning to be able to serve more veterans in the state of Georgia. I'll be glad to answer any questions, Mr. President.
Is there a fiscal note on this? Fiscal note.
There is no fiscal note. This is a cut.
Are there questions of the senator? I see none, Senator.
Thank you. I yield the well.
Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the bill? Is objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which is favorable passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall the main question be now put? Are there any objections? The chair hears none. The main question is ordered. Shall this bill now pass? The question is on the passage of the bill. All those in favor of the bill will vote yea. Those opposed, nay. And the secretary will unlock the machine. What purpose is to rise? Let me give the results and I'll call on you. On the passage of the bill, the yeas are 50, the nays are none. The bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Chair recognizes the distinguished chairman of Transportation.
Thank you, Mr. President. Just want to report in a bipartisan effort, the Transportation Committee has met and have approved all measures and will be offering the report to the Secretary of the Senate soon.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Delightful report. Sounds like a South Georgia auctioneer in a tobacco barn. Secretary will read House Bill 811.
House Bill 811 by Representative Powell, the 171st, and others. Bill to be entitled an act to amend Part 1 of Article 4 of Chapter 12 of Title 45 of the OCGA relating to management of budgetary and financial affairs and for other purposes. The Committee of the Senate on Appropriations recommend this bill do pass by substitute. Senate Appropriations Committee offers the following substitute to House Bill 811. Bill to be entitled an act to amend Titles 45, 12, 15 of the OCGA relating to public officers and employees, conservation and natural resources, and courts, respectively, and for other purposes.
Chair recognizes the Senator from the 7th, Senator from Coffey.
Thank you, Mr. President. I bring before you today House Bill, and this bill passed the House 811, 145-1. And this bill is a good first effort to begin dealing with the fees of four of the programs that the fees were intended to go towards. And what it does, it places in a mechanism going forward that if fees, if the revenue shortfall reserve is above a certain level, then we either fully fund the fee for what it's for, or then we begin reducing the fee. And I think that's the first good start towards that. If you'll notice, there should be a handout where we have the county commissioners, the Georgia Association of Police, Georgia Municipal Association, the Sheriff's Association, all of those, we've all worked together to come up with this language, and I would appreciate your support. I'll yield the well for questions.
You have a question from Senator 41st.
Yield?
Yes.
Senator, I want to know some of the differences in the original House version and the version as amended that we have before us today. Now, is this the real meat of the bill? Is it effective or only effective upon a certain amount of money in the reserve fund? And
There's a 7% trigger. For instance, if the prior year spending was $16.5 billion, 7% trigger, then it'd be about $1.1 billion would need to be in the revenue shortfall reserve before this bill would kick in.
So, Senator, do you have any idea what the timeline or expectation would be that we would be able to fund that? That we would be at the reserve strength?
No, over the last 10 years, from 2000 to 2010, if we would have looked at the revenue shortfall reserve, four of the years we would have been able to, this would have kicked in, six of the years it wouldn't have kicked in. And those 6 years, it would have given us the flexibility, the fund, the more important issues that we're concerned with.
And, Senator, the areas that the bill covers that will kick in under this bill, have they been limited from the effect of the original bill on what funds and...
Senator, will you please repeat the question? I can't hear you.
Does this bill only limit to a certain number of appropriated functions which it will be in effect for, or does it take on all the functions that were previously implemented in the original bill?
These are just the four listed.
And the original bill would have been for all the
the public defenders, and they asked to be removed. I think they're going for a constitutional amendment to be able to have them completely dedicated.
And Senator, do you have some concern now on the amount of monies that we do appropriate for certain purposes, but don't get to those purposes? Do you think this is, money that is well taken out and put into other areas, or do you have a concern that we're not funding, the Hazard Waste Trust Fund or other items pretty sincerely?
Well, I guess the quick answer to that, I would rather put a dollar towards education than I would cleaning up a tire.
Mm-hmm. Senator, further you.
Yes.
Would it be more appropriate then to try to have a tax that is for education rather than have a tax that is for a trust fund for waste or tires and then take it for education?
Would you please repeat the question?
Wouldn't it be more appropriate to properly designate what our taxes are supposed to be for than have a trust fund set up for one purpose
and then take that money and put it somewhere else.
Again, Senator, I think it's more important that we put the funds towards what we consider important. I would think education, public safety is a little bit more important than picking up a tire.
But Senator, don't you think it's important that when we debate issues and we put a fee on something that we're honest with the citizens of Georgia on what our real intent is?
Senator, as you know, if it's not a constitutional amendment, the money goes to the general fund for each of this body to appropriate.
That's all I see, Senator.
Thank you. I yield the well.
Chair recognizes Senator 41st to speak to the bill.
Mr. President, members of the Senate, and to the Secretary of Senate, apologize, I got a late arriving amendment. I had it earlier done, but it was some flaws. Basically, what the amendment will do is restore this bill to what it was as it passed the House. Something that truly caused us to try to fund the areas that we have fees for. And it does so in a manner that this bill does if we hit the 7% camp, 4% budget surplus, short reserve fund. It does it in a similar manner. It does it in a progressive way where, you know, if the monies are allotted or not fully where they're supposed to be, you need to go up a certain percent each year to get to the figure where we're putting the money where we say we're going to put it. I, too, realize that we've been in a economic downturn, and sometimes you have to change on a dime. But to have to take millions after millions after millions from our stated purpose, to be able to show honesty and integrity with our constituents, when we pass a tax and a fee and say we have passed that tax and fee for a hazardous waste trust fund or to help people with brain injuries in courts or for 911 fees that we have security, to continue year after year, it's going to our constituents and saying this is why you're paying this fee, while we know full and well that that is not the case, that is not where that money's going, is not the best practice. Unfortunately, in the Senate committee, we have put these barriers to make it effective. We have limited to a very finite group what funds are affected, and we have put in that it won't even kick in until we have a 7% in the shortfall reserve. So, you know, I think it's important that we take a stand here today, make this amendment. It will be slightly changed because it is an amendment, and we can go back to the House, talk about this. But I think we're certainly not moving far enough in this bill in addressing the concerns of millions of Georgia citizens that we're telling them we're going to raise money for one project or for one item, and we're really raising money and putting it somewhere else, and not always in the wonderful field of education, which was stated. Sometimes that money goes other places. All needed. We have short funds in almost all areas of state government, but we need to be honest with the taxpayers, and we pass a fee. We need to tell them what that fee is for and try to get the money there. This bill means really nothing at the present time because we're far off the shortfall reserve fund and won't be effective, and certainly once it does get in effect, if ever, it will only apply to some very limited scope. So my amendment's being printed. If there's any questions I can answer now, or I can wait until it's printed and come back to the well if there's anybody requests the president to have
you
me
have,
do so.
You have two questions, two senators want a question. Senator, you want to take them now?
I'll take them now.
Chair recognizes Senator Fourth. Oh, you're going to speak? Chair recognizes Senator from the 42nd.
The Senator yield.
I yield.
Senator, is it not true that if we pass the Senate substitute, we would be saying that we're only going to be honest with the taxpayers about where their fees go when there's a certain amount of money in our reserve fund?
That is correct. We'll do that, and only for a limited scope of projects.
Do you think that we ought to be honest every year, no matter how much money is in our reserve fund?
I think that we certainly need to try to set that as our goal, Senator. And under the original bill, there's still certain room for a shortfall that, you know, is quickly replaced. There is certain play in a case of a scream emergency, but let's set that for our goal. This amendment that I'm putting in will get us much closer to that and on much more areas in these limited fees.
Only questions I see, Senator.
Thank you. Yield well. If there's any questions, I could come back down once you see the amendment.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 4th, Senator from Tatnall. Speak to the bill.
Thank you, Mr. President. Members of the Senate, I won't take but a second just to ask you to consider voting against the amendment and return it to the work of your subcommittee and your committee. You know, you hear a lot of conversation about the work of the committee process, and so I will tell you that in the Appropriations Committee, this bill was assigned to a subcommittee led by the Senator from the 7th, and in consultation with the executive branch and with others in trying to do what's best for the state, we came up with this language. As far as the time it takes to accumulate $1.5 billion or $1 billion or whatever, we did it in 3 years in the middle of this decade. We accumulated $1.8 billion in about 3 years. So, you know, when times get better, it's easy to do. Each year, what's happening right now, and frankly, let me just take a second and tell you, in the scrap tire fund, we actually have a good record in that fund. If you look back over the 10 years, we were at 80-90% most of those years. When we hit the recession in 04 and 05, we used those funds for other things like teachers or health care or whatever we needed the funds for. Went back up the next year and back up, and we recovered and continued to fully fund it until we hit the second recession, which is pretty much unprecedented. The reason you need that flexibility is the same reason that states like Alabama have a real struggle when they have a recession, is because they have wide numbers of designated funds. The executive branch and your legislative branch needs the ability to put funds where you need them so that the taxpayers' use of those funds get the highest and best use. We've already started replacing the funds in these funds. This year's budget includes, the budget you passed yesterday includes $881,000 in new funds for the scrap tire fund. So, you know, the process is working as well. There's a public policy debate about fees, but I would assert to you that if you don't have a dollar to put in a classroom from here, you're going to have to get it from somewhere else. But the main thing is you're going to have to fund essential services, and that's what we have done through these two recessions this 10-year period. I think everybody's doing the best we can. I think the motives of the spending on these funds, if you look historically at them, we have always met the most essential needs of the Hazardous Waste Trust Fund. We've always met the list that came forward from DNR for the list of scrap tire cleanups. We've always met those essential needs. We've done our very best, I think, in every one of these to do that. So the fact that we have a trigger just gives us the flexibility that if times drop down, then we'll have a flexibility to use it to its highest and best use. And so I'd urge you to support this committee process, as we've done a couple of times this week. Support the work of your subcommittee and send the bill back to the House, and let's move ahead. I think that as it stands right now, it's a good piece of legislation which starts the process of recovering fees for their best use. Thank you, Mr. President.
You have a question, Senator, you want to take? Chair recognizes Senator 41st for a question.
Senator.
Yes, sir.
In the
I yield, by the way.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Senator, and I apologize. Thank you very much. In the long term, don't you think it should be a goal that we should try to expand this bill to include those other agencies?
Well, here's what I would tell you, and I've told this to folks in the hall and everywhere else. You can do what the Public Defenders Group has done. They have a constitutional amendment that's in the committee right now. We intend to pass out that we'll put the ballot. If it gets two-thirds vote in the House and the Senate, it'll be put on the ballot next year. The voters will decide to designate those funds. If they don't pass that, then they'll continue to be allocated as we see fit. The truth is, the Public Defenders Fund is going to top out here in just a few years. We're only about $3 million away from the top of those funds. So, you know, there's always the option when you try to implement any new fee. You have an option today when you introduce that legislation. Are you going to pass it by code, which takes a majority vote? Are you going to designate those funds by passing a constitutional amendment? If you got to get a two-thirds vote in the House and Senate and then pass it out there in the public. If you don't do that, then that assumes one thing. That assumes that you either did not care whether the funds totally went to that system or not, or you didn't think you had the support to do it. Either way, that is the avenue to designate funds. And, you know, this legislation, I think, is fine. It does send the message that we're concerned about it, but it does tie reality in the way of tying it to the reserve fund. I think it's absolutely the right way to do it.
Thank you, Senator.
Thank
you. If you further yield, just one more question.
Sure. Yes, sir.
On the 7% for the reserve fund, where are we now with that, and where do you expect us to be with the reserve fund, you know, surplus? Where do you expect to be in the next few years?
$300 million, I think, before we took out the 1.5%, so it's a couple of $100 million right today. As I said, we built up $1.5 billion in 3 years when times were good. We went down to less than $50 million in 2003 or four. We were almost at zero for a couple of years. In just 3 years, we accumulated $1.6 billion. So when times are better, it'll build pretty fast. Thank you, and I yield the will.
Thank you. Senator 41st, you want to address your amendment? You complete?
Thank you, Mr. President. I did have one question, whether or not this was longer than half and would cause the bill to lay over. The answer is no. As I stated earlier, this restores the language in the House that passed that would make it apply to a broader area of places where we collect state fees and what we direct our funding for certain projects, collect fees, tell the public that it's for that certain purpose, get some money to the purpose, and takes out the reserve fund language, so it's a process that we can start now. It's not immediate. It does have certain calibers that we can get to that level of paying for the fees where we say they're going to go. It is a matter of honesty to government. And as the senator from the fourth said, you know, if we tell the public, you know, that money is supposed to go for a certain purpose and we should put that purpose, if we can get a constitutional amendment, get the public to support that, that's what we should do. But we should not then find another mechanism to lie to people, to say we're going to collect money for this purpose, we're not going to put it up for a vote, we're not going to get your input, but we're going to go home and tell you this money is being collected for this purpose, and then we take that money and we spend it somewhere else in the state budget. It's not the type of openness and disclosure we'd like to see, and it certainly is something that we can change here today by adopting this amendment. We yield the well if there's no questions.
Thank you. Secretary will read the title of the amendment.
Senator Henson from the 41st and others offers the following amendment. Amend the Senate Appropriations Committee substitute to House Bill 811 by deleting lines 12 through 145 and inserting in lieu of the following. As used in this code section, the term base amounts means the amount of free proceeds collected during the complete fiscal year and for other purposes.
Questions on the adoption of the floor amendment by the Senator from 41st to the committee substitute. Is there objection to the adoption of the floor amendment to the committee substitute? There is. All those in favor of the amendment as presented by the Senator from 41st will rise, stand, and be counted. Senator 39th has moved the ayes and nays. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Clearly more than five have voted. Hearing this, the Secretary will unlock the machine. All those in favor will vote yea. Those opposed, nay. Unlock the machine.
I got it. Thank
On the adoption of the floor amendment to the committee substitute, the yeas are 16, the nays are 34. The floor amendment is not adopted. The question is on the committee substitute. Is the objection to the adoption of the committee substitute? Hearing none, the committee substitute is adopted. Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the bill? Is the objection to agreeing to the report of the committee which is favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair has none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall the main question be now put? Are there any objections? The chair has none. The main question is ordered. Shall this bill now pass by substitute? The question is on the passage of the bill. All those in favor will vote yea. Those opposed, nay. And the secretary will unlock the machine. On the passage of the bill, the yeas are 45, the nays are 7. The bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Chair recognizes the senator from the 34th for a special presentation and announcement.
Thank you, Mr. President, members of the Senate. I rise to bring awareness to today for a very special young lady who is having a birthday today. She has actually helped us tremendously. Not only is she young, talented, smart, she is beautiful as well. So if you would join me in wishing Meg Robinson a very happy birthday. Happy birthday, Meg. I yield the well.
We will spare the singing of happy birthday since Joey Brush is no longer with us in this Senate. No. We'll move along. Third readings. We'll have at this point third readings and consideration of general bills and resolutions. Secretary will read HB 35. 835.
House Bill 835, Representative Roberts of the 154th and others. Bill to be entitled an act to amend Article 2, Chapter 6 of Title 32 of the OCGA relating to weight and dimensions of vehicles and loads and for other purposes. The Senate Committee on Transportation recommends that this bill do pass.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 7th to explain the bill. Again, the Senator from Coffey.
Thank you, Mr. President. I bring before you House Bill 835, and these are one of the bills you would think that you wouldn't have to bring because of common sense. But basically, this bill provides for an annual commercial wreck or emergency tow permit. Basically what we found out, and this is between the DOT as well as the wrecker services, is that when a wrecker is called on, for instance, I-75 to come pick up a semi or Walmart trailer or so forth, immediately when they hook up, they're illegal. And there's been some cases where they've been fined. So what this does, it gives an annual permit for them to be able to, as emergency wrecker service, get these trailers off of the 75 and open up the traffic. And I will yield for questions.
Question from the Senate 34th.
Thank you, Mr. President. Will the Senator yield?
Yes.
Senator, with this weight, added weight, can you speak to the safety of hauling that extra weight on our interstate?
Senator, really you don't have a choice because you've got to move the trailers and so forth. This is for emergency towing wreckers. So when you have a truck or whatever, a Walmart truck or semi that's blocking or whatever, someone's got to pick them up. And so this allows them to go do this without, right now under the law, when they hook up, the wait is over. And so this allows them to do so.
I see. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
The chair is familiar with what rolls out of Douglas, Georgia, too. Thank you. That's all the questions.
Thank you.
Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the bill? Is the objection to agreeing to the report of the committee which is favorable passage of the bill? Chair has none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall the main question be now put? Are there any objections? The chair has none. And the main question is ordered. Shall this bill now pass? Questions on the passage of the bill? All those in favor of the bill will vote yea. Those opposed nay. And the secretary will unlock the machine. On the passage of the bill, the yeas are 47, the nays are a mighty one. The bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Secretary will read House Bill 879.
House Bill 879 by Representative Ramsey, the 72nd, and others. A bill to be entitled an act to amend Part 3 of Article 16 of Chapter 2, Title 20 of the OCGA, relating to student health in elementary and secondary education and for other purposes. The Committee of the Senate on Health and Human Services recommends that this bill do pass by substitute. Senate Health and Human Services Committee offers the following substitute to House Bill 879. A bill to be entitled an act to amend Part 3 of Article 16 of Chapter 2, Title 20 of the OCGA, relating to student health in elementary and secondary education and for other purposes.
Chair recognizes the Senator from the 16th to present the bill.
That was almost a great intro.
Thank you, Mr. President. Ladies and gentlemen of the Senate, I come before you today on House Bill 879. We just passed 879. And this bill is very important for our students in our public schools, particularly those that have diabetes. I'm going to talk just a moment about the specifics of the bill, just a brief summary of the bill, and then I'll be happy to answer any questions. House Bill 879, which, by the way, passed the House 136-26, provides important support and resources for those children that have diabetes in our public schools to make sure that they're in a safe and healthy environment. The bill, we've got four things that the bill does. It requires the state to develop training resources for schools. There is absolutely no cost for this training. And we're asking that two persons in the public schools have this training. This training takes about 2 hours. It is provided at no cost by the American Diabetes Association. And also, you know, a lot of the school nurses already have this training, and they can get it again after about 2 hours. About 2 hours. The reason we're trying to do this is because these kids obviously need to make sure that they are being taken care of in a safe and healthy environment. And I want to talk about a couple of things that I know are going to come up, or some issues that I've heard from folks. The bill also provides that the children with parental consent can have the authority to do their own blood sugar test and insulin injections. And this is very critical for every person with knowledge of the disease knows that we've got to make sure that the children are managing this at an early age so they can manage it as adults. The bill also provides, very importantly, the bill also provides liability immunity to those that take these training classes to help the students. Thank you, Mr. President. Several questions have come up in some of the discussions that I've had with members of the Senate. And one of the things that we keep hearing about is this a mandate? Well, the Americans with Disabilities Act mandates that schools make medical accommodations for children with this disease. So the schools are mandated to make sure they're taking care of the children with diabetes, but many schools don't have the proper training. The people who are supposed to be taking care of the students have never been trained. So the argument can be made that we need to do this to make sure, from a liability standpoint, and to make sure also that the school administrators, the teachers, the nurses are getting the proper training to make sure that these students are taken care of in the event of any kind of catastrophic event. Another thing we've talked about, why diabetes? What about the other diseases? Well, diabetes is very unique because it is the only disease I'm aware of that requires a daily monitoring, hourly monitoring, making sure that the levels are where they need to be. Other diseases, other conditions, students, patients, victims, if you will, can take medication overnight or daily or at whatever point during the day to manage their condition. Diabetes is not that way. The disease must be managed on a daily basis to make sure that the levels are where they need to be and the students are healthy. Another portion of the bill talks about a medical management plan, and I've been asked, what is that? Basically, all that is a card or a piece of paper that the parents provide to the school detailing their students, their child's situation, such as their insulin to carb ratios and the optimum blood sugar range. So that's all they need to provide to the schools. I think it's a good bill for our students. I think it's something we need to do to make sure we're taking care of these very fragile members of our society. Mr. President, I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Chair recognizes Senator 45th for a question.
Mr. Chairperson, would you yield?
Absolutely.
Is it not true that we have essentially agreed that we're not going to go down the road of this year it's diabetes, next year it's asthma, next year it's seizures, that this is an explicit bill and it's standalone?
Madam Chairwoman, absolutely.
And is it also not true that at the same time school personnel is taught how to do CPR, that diabetes training could be done at the same time?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
No more questions, sir.
Thank you. I yield the will.
The question is on the adoption of the committee substitute. Is there objection to the adoption of the committee substitute? Hearing none, the committee substitute is adopted. Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the bill? Is the objection to agreeing to the committee substitute with favorable passage of the bill? Chair has none. The committee's report is agreed to. Shall this main question be now put? Are there any objections? The chair has none. The main question is ordered. Shall the bill now pass by substitute? The question's on the passage of the bill. All those in favor of the bill will vote yea. Those opposed, nay. And the secretary will unlock the machine. Is he back there? Yeah. On the passage of the bill, the yeas are 35, the nays are 14. The bill, having received the requisite constitutive majority, is therefore passed. Chair recognizes Senator 53rd for a motion.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Give me your attention, please.
I ask for unanimous consent to waive the rules in order to read the committee report of the Transportation Committee.
Chairman of Transportation, I ask to waive the rules of reading of the committee report and consideration of general bills and resolutions. Secretary will read the report.
Mr. President, the Senate Transportation Committee has had under consideration the following legislation, has instructed me to report the same back to the Senate with the following recommendation. Senate Resolution 1211, do pass. Senate Resolution 1213, do pass. House Resolution 1177, do pass by substitute. Respectfully submitted, Senator Mullis of the 53rd District Chairman. Senate Resolution 1211 by Senator Underman of the 45th, Transportation Department, urged to seek alternative options to alleviate motor vehicle congestion throughout Metro Atlanta. Senate Resolution 1213 by Senator Miller of the 49th, Senate Complete Street Study Committee, create. House Resolution 1177 by Representative Williams of the 113th and others, Veterans Memorial Highway, Oglethorpe County, dedicate, through the order, Mr. President.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Chair recognizes the Secretary to read House Bill 985.
House Bill 985 by Representative Powell of the 29th and others. Bill to be entitled now to amend Title 40 of the OCGA relating to motor vehicles and traffic so as to modify provisions relating to temporary license plates for motor vehicles and for other purposes. Senate Committee on Public Safety recommends that this bill do pass.
I saw you do. The folder's on my desk if you need it. Chair recognizes the Senator from the 53rd to speak to the bill. Yeah. Get the folder.
Thank you, Mr. President. I come before you with House Bill 985. This is the Department of Revenue's housekeeping bill. It deals with tag issues primarily, or the temporary tag. This allows the surrenderer not have to surrender the tag if he needs the temporary tag, if he needs it longer in order to find the deed if it's a transaction between individuals and by affidavit. Also it provides that the physical composition of a temporary tag, it talks about that and the new requirements regarding that. It also it gives the authority for the Department of Driver Services to release information to the Department of Revenue in order for investigation about fraud regarding licenses and tags. Mr. President, I could go on and on about this issue, but I've said everything. But I'll be glad to answer any questions.
Chair Reinhardt, Senate 33rd.
Isn't it true, Mr. Chairman, that you've had many things on your mind and many bills, and we were referring to it a title and not a deed.
Thank you for clarification there, Senator.
Thank you.
And your wisdom that you give this body every day. Mr. President, I'll be glad to yield unless there are further questions.
Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the bill? Is objection to agreeing to the report of the passage which committee favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair has none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall the main question be now put? Are there any objections? The chair hears none. The main question is ordered. Shall this bill now pass? The question's on the passage of the bill. All those in favor will vote yea. Those opposed, nay. And the secretary will unlock the machine. Thank you. On the passage of the bill, the yeas are 48, the nays are 0. The bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Secretary will read House Bill 1132.
House Bill 1132 by Representative Dickey of the 136 and others. Bills have been titled an act to amend Part 2 of Article 15 of Chapter 1 of Title 10 of the OCGA relating to the Fair Business Practices Act of 1975 and for other purposes.
The what Committee purpose of the Senate on Rise?
Industries and Utilities recommend that this bill do pass.
Mr. President, will you instruct the Secretary of the Senate to read the rule 5-1.8 on voting prohibitions, 5-1.8A?
Secretary will so read. Stand at ease.
Five 1.8 voting prohibitions. No senator or person shall vote for or attempt to vote for another senator on any questions. Violation of this rule shall be deemed to be disorderly behavior and subject to punishment as provided by the Constitution and rules of the Senate. This rule cannot be suspended by unanimous consent.
Rules of the Senate, ladies and gentlemen. Secretary will read House Bill 1132. Have you completed that?
House Bill 1132 by Representative Dickey of the 136 and others. Bill to be entitled an act to amend Part 2 of Article 15 of Chapter 1 of Title 10 of the OCGA relating to the Fair Business Practices Act of 1975 and so as to provide for oversight of the administrator of certain telemarketing practices and for other purposes. The Committee of the Senate Regulated Industries and Utilities recommends that this bill do pass.
Chair recognizes Senator 18th to present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. President. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen of the Senate. I'm pleased to bring before you House Bill 1132. House Bill 1132 adds new language regulating telemarketing and solicitation services made into and within the state of Georgia. It creates a code of conduct for telemarketing, including the identification of the caller. You will certainly know that every one of us has received repeatable, unwanted, unsolicited telemarketing calls at home and even at our businesses. Some companies have resorted to using false telephone numbers for caller ID display. If you can look at the number, then you can at least ask to be added to the no-call list, but sometimes it's really not easy and sometimes even impossible to reach the company or know who is originating the call. These spam calls are costly to many businesses and many Georgians. This bill is simply an attempt to ensure that these calls will adhere to a code of ethics and conduct that any legitimate business would seek to follow. Mr. President, if there are no questions, I'll yield the well.
No questions, Senator.
I ask you for your support for House Bill 1132.
On the passage, does any other senator wish to speak for or against the bill? Is the objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which is favorable to passage of the bill? The chair has none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall the main question be now put? Are there any objections? The chair has none. And the main question is ordered. Shall the bill now pass? The question's on the passage of the bill. All those in favor of the bill will vote yea, those opposed nay, and the secretary will unlock the machine. No. On the passage of the bill, the yeas are 45, the nays are 0. The bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Congratulations, Representative Dickey. We're proud of you. Saved us a lot of heartache. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen of the Senate, the next two House resolutions are what is known as compensation resolutions. And for those of you that have not been in the Senate very long, this is an annual deal we do that follows the General Appropriations Act or the budget. And it cannot be passed until the General Appropriations Act is completed. And we completed that, and now we bring to you the general compensation resolutions. The Compensation Commission has recommended these to us. They have passed the House, they have passed the Senate subcommittee and committee. You have the report of the Secretary of State, who is chairman of the Compensation Commission, before you, and the figure. These two resolutions were actually assigned by the chairman of Appropriations to the senator for the 15th, but due to the untimely death of his wife, he is in Muskogee County with his family. Therefore, I am going to request the indulgence of the committee and ask the senator from the 29th to stand in his stead. Chair recognizes him, 29th. Read the caption. Read the caption.
House Resolution 1160 by Representative Hughley, the 133rd, and others. Resolution compensating Mr. Lathan Rydell Word and for other purposes.
Chair recognizes Senator 29.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise to present House Resolution 1160. This resolution provides compensation for Mr. Lathan Rydell Word. Mr. Word was wrongfully convicted of armed robbery and possession of a firearm in September of the year 2000. He was sentenced to 15 years in prison. He served almost 12 years of that sentence before his conviction was overturned by the Georgia Court of Appeals. There was a new trial ordered. He was given the opportunity at that time to simply plead guilty and receive time served. But he refused that offer. He demanded a new trial. At the new trial, the victim of the alleged crime, who subsequently was convicted and sentenced for murder and armed robbery, testified that he had not been truthful at the original trial, that Mr. Word had not committed the robbery in question. And as a result of that testimony, Mr. Word was exonerated of the crime and he was released. It's worth noting that 6 days prior to this incident for which Mr. Word was arrested, he was scheduled to begin Marine Corps boot camp. He was 17 years old at the time. Mr. Word is now 31. House Resolution 1160 would provide for as compensation for the almost 12 years he was wrongfully incarcerated, $400,000, which would be apportioned with an initial lump sum payment of $100,000 and the balance in a 20-year period that would be paid through an annuity. Mr. President, I'll yield to any questions. If there are no questions, I'll yield the will.
If you would, Senator, address your amendment or our amendment.
Oh, yes, I'll address the amendment. I believe there are actually two amendments that have been offered. Amendment one simply provides at the end of line 30 the following language, that none of the funds provided by this resolution shall be used to pay attorney's fees if such fees are calculated on a contingency fee basis, simply to ensure that these funds go to Mr. Word for his wrongful incarceration and not to any other source. There's a second amendment, which is simply correcting a Scrivener's error. If you look at line 17, when it is reciting the various losses Mr. Word has suffered as a result of his wrongful incarceration, the phrase loss of consortium TION appears, and that should be loss of consortium. So we have corrected that in Amendment 2. And it's my understanding both of those would be friendly amendments. And with that, Mr. President, I'll yield the well unless there are any questions.
You have one questioner. The Senator, Chair right has Senate 40th.
Gentleman yields.
Yes.
I guess my question is, in reading this letter that was just given to us from the Secretary of State, where they had this evidentiary hearing, it shows that no evidence was presented by Representatives Hughley and Smyre from the House, I guess, at the hearing. And what specifically, if you know, and if you don't, I apologize, I know it's not really your bill you're carrying. What specifically did the state do wrong in this particular case, if you know?
Certainly, I'd be glad to answer.
Because I think that's important based upon this letter that we just got. Because evidently Representative Hughley and Representative Smyre didn't have a clue in reading this letter.
Well, unfortunately, I think what was not included in the claim that was brought forward was the actual opinion that the Court of Appeals rendered that overturned Mr. Word's decision. In that opinion, they recited the fact that Mr. Word's counsel made a grievous error that resulted in the conviction. That counsel was a public defender provided to Mr. Word by the state of Georgia, and but for his ineffective assistance, Mr. Word, the court concluded, would not have ever been convicted. Yes, sir.
Follow up then. In other words, the state did not do their job for this gentleman, the public defender, in the eyes of the appellate court.
Exactly.
Thank you.
Chair recognizes Senator 33rd.
Senator Yu?
Yes, sir.
Isn't it true that on the same statement that was referred to just now that the committee, the constitutional committee that considers the resolutions, we're turning him down based on no statement of insurance coverage stating his claim is not covered by insurance, which would be doubtful for anybody. Claimant's affidavit of value of property form, and that those are the two documents which I don't know is even applicable, and certainly most people wouldn't have them. So, that seems to be not a very good reason to disallow the claim.
I would agree with you.
Too much.
Thank you.
No further questions, Senator. We are on amendment number 1, authored by the Senator from the 29th. Is there objection? Without objection, amendment number 1 is adopted. Now the question is on amendment number 2, authored by the Senator from the 29th. Is there objection? Without objection, amendment number 2, authored by the Senator of the 29th, is adopted. Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the resolution? Is the objection granted report of committee on which favorable passage of the adoption of the resolution? The chair is none. The report of committee is agreed to. Shall the main question be now put? Are there any objections? The chair is none. The main question is ordered. Shall this resolution be adopted? Questions on the adoption of the resolution. All those in favor will vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary, unlock the machine. on the passage of the resolution. The ayes are 36 and the nays are 14, and the resolution is adopted. Secretary will read H.R. 1161.
House Resolution 1161 by Representative Buckner, the 130th, and others. A resolution compensating Mr. James A. Colley and providing for a state income tax exclusion with respect to such compensation and for other purposes. The Committee of the Senate on Appropriations recommends that the bill do pass.
Chair recognized, Senator of the 14th, present the bill.
The senator from the 15th. This bill is another compensation resolution. This is strictly admitted and brought to us by the Department of Labor, not by the individual. There was no lawyers involved, and I'll tell you exactly what happened. This man went down to my hometown of Americus to sign his son up, he and his wife, for the Job Corps. While he was there, he slipped actually out of a chair that the Labor Department had placed in there that had wheels on them. On a concrete floor, they had wheels on the bottom of the chairs in the waiting room. And he slipped out, busted his head, busted his back, and everything else. The Labor Department staff rushed out and said, you know, what can we do? He said, don't do anything. I don't have a dime of insurance. My wife will take me home. Over his objections, Georgia State Department of Labor called the ambulance. The ambulance took the man to Sumter Regional Hospital. He was treated, and his hospital bills are here. He later went to a neurosurgeon in Macon, and they treated him for his injuries. And what you have here is the 100% of his medical bills. That is all he's asking for. This claim was brought to us not by the claimant, but by the Department of Labor, and they admitted their fault. They immediately the next day removed the wheels from the bottom of the chair and realized they never should have put wheels on the bottom of the chairs on the concrete floor. What you see before you, this small dollar amount, will pay Sumter Regional Hospital, it will pay the ambulance service, and pay his doctor bills, and that is all. I have all the medical reports and affidavits and so forth. Again, he didn't initiate this. The Labor Department did, and I present this to you in the absence of Senator Harbison. I'll be glad to answer any questions if anybody has any.
Chair recognized, Senator of the 49th.
Will the Senator yield?
Yes, sir.
Senator, why wasn't this handled by the Labor Department early on, and did they address it, and why are we addressing it now?
They did, Senator, and this is the process they have to follow. They called the man back in. They had a risk management assessment go through it, just like you'd have an adjuster. In other words, went through it, and the adjuster and the Labor Department brought this forward. They followed the pattern of asking for a compensation resolution. The Labor Department cannot pay him directly. They have to follow this route as by law.
Thank you, Senator.
Chair recognized, Senator on the 54th.
Thank you, Mr. President. Will the dean yield?
Yes.
Senator, I'm just trying to make sure I understand the advisory board letter that we have signed by the Secretary of State recommends $4,448.83. The original claim, as I read it, was in $19,569.83, and our resolution is $7,500. And I don't see in the record where $7,500 comes from. Should it be more or should it be less?
No, it should be the exact amount.
Okay.
The House of Representatives reduced it down to strictly a lot of the medical bills, negotiated them out. He actually owes Sumter Regional Hospital a little less than $5,000. The other is doctor bills and ambulance service. So they've got it correctly.
Thank you, Senator. Thank you, Mr. President.
No further questions, Senator.
Thank you. Urge adoption.
Before we take this vote, let me get the Senate's attention for just a moment. We have three pages that have been with us all day today, and we are so very proud of Kaylee Blanton, Zachary Clout, and Lauren Collins that are all in the back. Let's give them a round of applause. Thank you all very, very much. Good. We appreciate all of our pages and obviously our great coordinator, Miss Nancy, who we all love, huh? Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the resolution? Is the objection agreed and reported to committee, which failed to pass the bill? Chair is not reported to committee, is agreed to. Shall the main question be now put? Are there any objections? Chair is not the main question is ordered. Shall this bill now pass? Questions on the pass of the bill. All those in favor of the bill vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary will unlock the machine. On the passage of the resolution, the yeas are 33 and the nays are 16, and the resolution is therefore adopted. Chair recognizes item 27th, special order.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move that the Senate disagree to the House substitute to Senate Bill 110.
Disagree. Read the caption.
Senate Bill 110 by Senator Murphy, the 27th, and others. A bill to be entitled an act to amend Code Section 12.8.25.3 of the OCGA relating to further restrictions on municipal solid waste landfill sites within significant groundwater recharge areas or new military airspace and for other purposes.
Is there objection? Without objection, the Senate has disagreed. Send it back to the House. Chair recognizes Senator on the 30th.
Thank you, Mr. President. I ask unanimous consent to suspend Senate Rule 3-1.2C and read House Bill 1176 for the first time.
Is there objection? Without objection, read the caption, I'm sorry. Oh, read the bill.
House Bill 1176 by Representative Golic of the 34th and others. A bill to be entitled an act to amend Chapter 1 of Title 15 and Title 16 of the OCGA related to general provisions relative to courts and crimes and offenses, respectively, so as to enact provisions recommended by the 2011 Special Counsel on Criminal Justice Reform for Georgians and for other purposes.
Does any senator wish to rise on a point of personal privilege? Chair recognizes Senator from the 21st.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move that the Senate stand adjourned until Monday at 1 p.m.
Let me, before we read the announcements, let me have the Senate's attention for just a moment. As the Senator from the 14th pointed out earlier, pertaining to the adjournment resolution, we want to be very, very respectful, obviously, of the Senator from the 15th and his family. Arrangements have not been set. When we do get arrangements, we will notify senators to let you know and make decisions that might be necessary. But as it stands right now, 1 o'clock on Monday. Secretary will read the announcements.
1 p.m. Education and Youth has been canceled. 1 p.m. Insurance and Labor has been postponed. Rules is meeting upon adjournment. Upon adjournment of rules, Finance is meeting 310 CLOB. Upon adjournment of rules, Regulated Industries and Utilities is meeting in the mezzanine. State Institutions and Property is meeting upon adjournment of the Senate. Transportation has been adjourned. Appropriations Conference Committee on House Bill 742 is meeting at 4 p.m., 403 in the Capitol.
Scan that in.
Scan it.
The majority leader has moved that the Senate stand adjourned until 1 o'clock on Monday. All those in favor will say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, no.
No.
I love it when the Senate likes to work, but the ayes clearly have it. We stand adjourned.